Welcome to the American Humanist Association's Speaking of Humanism series. My name is Emily Newman, and I'm the AHA's Senior Education Coordinator. Today, I'm happy to share on death, dying, and disbelief with Candace Gorham. Candace is a licensed mental health counselor and author. She is also a member of the Secular Therapist Project, the Clergy Project, the Secular Student Alliance Speakers Bureau, and a board member of the American Humanist Association. Thank you so much for being with us, Candace.
Hey, thank you for having me. So as she said, just a little bit about my background. I was raised Jehovah's Witness. I did that for a number of years until my parents separated. And then I started going to what was the family church, which was United Methodist Church. I went there for a number of years. I was confirmed in the Methodist Church. I went through all of that stuff as a young child. And then when I got to high school is when my religious background really started to get a little bit more extreme. My senior year of high school, my sister married a minister, and he was that more extreme, Pentecostal holiness type minister. And so we did a lot of the more extreme things like casting out demons, speaking in tongues, you know, shouting. But we believed in things like faith healing and, sowing and reaping, paying your tithes, all of that stuff. And he was very much into stuff that you might think of as like prosperity gospel. So there was a lot of financial investment that we had in that ministry and everything. And so I did that for a number of years, and my sister and her husband ended up moving to another state. And so that's how I ended up getting out of that church. I went to another church for a little bit of time. That was a mega church, a prosperity gospel type church. And was there, and I like sang in the choir, and I was, you know, involved, highly, highly involved there as well. And I went through a period of my life where things just got really dark for me. My mental health was suffering. Financially, I was suffering. My marriage was suffering. Just a lot was going on in my world. And so I began to sort of question my beliefs, and not in the sense of like, maybe there's no God, but I started questioning in the sense that I must be doing something wrong. In fact, the pastor of the church that mega church that I was a member of, he used to actually say that. He would say, if you're not living like me, you're doing something wrong. And so that really, I started to take that to heart. And with all of the things that I was going through, I did start to feel like I must be doing something wrong. And so I chose to sort of take a step back from church and try to start studying on my own, maybe revisit some texts that I had not, you know, read in a while, or, you know, I started buying books and started just, you know, educating myself more on just religion in general, as well as just trying to, you know, study the Bible more. I also started just studying religion in general. And that's how I kind of came across things about problems with the Bible, how the Bible was created, and issues with translations and things. I started learning about things like the, you know, hell isn't necessarily what we've been told in pop culture hell is. And, I started reading, learning more about that. And I was a biblical literalist. So I believe that exactly what the Bible said was true. So if the Bible said that the earth was made in 6 days, I believed it was made in six regular days. And so as things started to crumble for me in terms of my religious beliefs, in terms of how I saw the Bible as it wasn't really a trustworthy text, then I started to, my beliefs started to crumble as well with it. And so that's kind of how I ended up getting out of religion in general, was just the sort of studying myself and realizing that things were not what I thought they were. And so I kind of went into one of those agnostic phase. I went through like a spiritual phase, like there's something out there, but I don't know, but there's something. And then I went through an agnostic phase, and I just sort of, you know, went through a bunch of different phases. I even played around with like Wicca for a little while. Like I was just doing all kind of things for a little while. I slowly sort of made myself to atheism and humanism as a result of study It wasn't a matter of like being angry with God or anything like that. So that's just a little bit about me and my background and how I got to be where I am today. And, you know, like she pointed out, you know, I'm a member of all these various organizations and projects. So what I'm here to talk to you about today is my book on death, dying, and disbelief that came out last year, last fall of 2021. And why did I write this book? So in 2019, my high school sweetheart died he was in a car accident. And he and I had really reconnected over recent years. We both had gotten divorced and, you know, we reconnected and became friends again and we got close again. And I, you know, we had a really special relationship. And so when he died, it was just beyond devastating. I went through deep depression for a long time and it was just really ugly. And in the book, on death, dying, and disbelief, I do talk in almost like graphic detail about what the grief was like and how painful and how heavy and how all encompassing it was for me and my life at that time. And so about the time of the 1 year anniversary of his death, I thought I had been doing well. You know, I had gotten to the place where, you know, I could look at his picture and smile instead of crying. And, you know, I could talk about him instead of crying. And that 1 year anniversary came and the grief hit me again like a ton of bricks. And I went right back into day one grief. And I thought, oh, this was just such a horrible year. I cannot do this again. And I began to wonder, what can I do? How can I process my grief? And that's how I came around to writing the book. I pitched it to my publisher and he, you know, was like, yeah, sounds like a resource we need. Also around that same time, I had a couple of friends who were also grieving the deaths of lovers and family members. And that was, you know, just sort of trying to be there to support them also made me realize, they're both atheists and humanists. And so being there for both of them sort of made me realize like, this is really something that's needed. And of course, in times that I've, you know, spoken at conferences about mental health issues, I've done grief related presentations years ago in the past. And I would always get questions about grief management and how do non-believers go about managing grief? Because grief and death and mourning and all those things are kind of relegated to the realm of like the spiritual, right? It seems like it just automatically fits with religious beliefs for some reason. And so we definitely need resources as non-believers, as humanists, as atheists, agnostics. We need resources that do not depend on, you know, prayer and, you know, sitting around in the church. So that's what triggered it. You know, there are some sites out there, there's some materials out there, but there's not a lot for non-believers. And so those are the reasons that I decided to write this book. It was part, you know, personal healing type thing that I was trying to go through, and in part, you know, trying to be a resource to others who are going through similar things. Just a couple quick definitions here. Grief, mourning, and bereavement are all slightly different variations on a theme. Grief is defined as the natural response to loss that a person experiences. Emotional, physical, behavior, cognitive, social, spiritual, all of that. Mourning is just the outward expression. So crying, wailing, all of those things, that is the actual mourning. So grief is sort of just a natural response. Mourning is what you actually do. And then bereavement, as it says, is just the period of time that you're in mourning. And I recently did a talk on research for atheists and non-believers in grief. And I decided not to kind of go over all of that again. It was kind of a heavy presentation in terms of focusing on research and statistics and stuff like that. So I decided not to go over all of that again, but I did want to point out a couple of details that I came across as I was studying more deeply, you know, what does the research say about grief for non-believers? Because again, like I said, oftentimes we think of that as being something that happens in the spiritual world, but what, you know, there's a lot of research about spirituality being beneficial for those in mourning. But there's not a whole lot of research about, you know, well, what do those of us who aren't spiritual do? But I was able to come across some. I scrounged up some research here and there, doing some searching around. And over multiple studies and different ways in which they've studied, you know, the impact of non-belief on religion, on grief and mourning, three main things kind of came out. And that is that atheists and non-believers are trying to find meaning in their lives and maintaining a connection with friends and family is important, and then enjoying experiencing the natural world. So this is sort of like what are the things that non-believers found to be, report to be beneficial in their grief and mourning processes. And again, it says, you know, finding meaning, connecting with people, and enjoying the natural world. And I think, you know, that sounds a lot like what a lot of humanists, you know, philosophies are all about, right? It's about making our own meaning because we're all we have. And so it's about connecting to other people because we're all we have. You know, it's about taking care of the earth and enjoying the natural world because it's all we got. And so I thought it was interesting that that is what comes up in the research as far as, you know, what non-believers report to be beneficial to them. Other things that came out is this naturalistic method of finding meaning in the world, finding meaning through just better self-understanding in general. A lot of people find that, you know, just spending time learning about themselves, working on themselves, you know, seeing a therapist, you know, whatever it takes to kind of become the better version of yourself and to get to know yourself better. That is another thing that's considered to be something that helps non-believers make meaning and therefore be able to deal with death and loss. Examples of atheist coping are things that, like the belief that one's legacy will live on based on good deeds in life. Again, sounds very humanistic, right? This is all we have. We got to do the best that we got while we're here. Also acceptance of the reality of aging and physical decline, right? I know in a lot of conversations that I've had with non-believers, we do seem to have a pretty good grasp on the fact that we're going to die. This is all coming to an end someday. And, you know, we got to try to make the best of what we got while we can. And so that also is something that just general acceptance of aging and physical decline, maybe not necessarily in the context of, oh, my high school sweetheart died, I got to accept this, but just sort of a general life point of view that, like, this is what we got, this is what we kind of got to deal with, and we might as well go ahead and come to terms with it now so that by the time somebody actually does pass away, we already are sort of in a place of accepting that that's what happens, and you know, and we just kind of got to learn to live with it. I know for me, with my loss, a lot of what I did in the beginning had to do with, it was difficult for me to accept the reality of aging and physical decline because his was a result of a car accident. He was 42 years old, perfect health, right? And so that doesn't always work depending on the way the death occurred, but it did. Over time, I was able to tap into this sense of, you know, it had to happen someday, you know, it was going to happen someday. He wasn't going to be here forever. And so I kind of, after the sting of it dies down the most, I do believe that I did kind of tap into that overall acceptance that, you know, where you knew that you or he, one of you guys were going to go first and one of you were going to have to deal with this, you know, just turned out to be me. I had other information about the different things that what they call like religious coping. And it was the sort of things that you would expect. I didn't include it here because, again, like I said, it was the sort of things that you would expect. Prayer, you know, doing good deeds, going to church, that sort of thing, spending time with other church members. Those were things that were found to be top coping skills that religious people use to deal with grief and death. And so because research often looks at research on grief and death and dying, often looks at it from a through a spiritual lens to say, well, what helps? Ooh, spirituality helps. Let's dig into spirituality some more. So there's just a plethora of research that says praying helps, you know, those sort of things help. That's if that's what the research says, it helps. You know, I'm not gonna, I mean, it's just a lot of research that says this. And, you know, I think that there can be, it can be understandable. I think we probably can understand that the reasons in which something like prayer or spending time with other believers, why those things could be beneficial, right? Because if we believe in a life after death, we believe, oh, the person's in heaven, the person's watching over us, the person's going to be there when we get there. You know, if you kind of have that fairy tale to lean on, it can be comforting. What the, so there was no evidence of difference in effectiveness between religious and atheist belief-based coping. So there's not a whole lot that says believers fare better than non-believers. In fact, you know, the research that I read was showing that, you know, atheists, non-believers, humanists are able to fare just as well and sometimes better, because there's also research that talks about how certain types of praying is not beneficial. And so that type, the prayers that involve like begging and pleading and things that could potentially lead to anger at God, those sorts of things, of course, you know, do not lead to positive outcomes and do not help religious people cope any better. So in some ways, non-believers do cope better because they don't end up with that particular struggle, right? We don't end up with this anger at God. We don't end up with the same, you know, begging and pleading for somebody. Although I will say, I'm going to come back to it because I'm going to touch on it shortly. I'm going to come back to what I'm going to say here in a minute. So that is a little bit about the research. About the book, there are 10 tips. The book is based on 10 tips. You know, you have to forgive me. I'm going to read them real quick. A few years ago, I was reading some things on the slide, and at the end of the presentation, someone commented that they thanked me for reading because they were blind and they couldn't read. And so they have a problem when they attend a lot of talks that people don't read the slides. And so they don't know what is being said. So you have to forgive me. I took that to heart and I have since decided that, you know, the most important meat I will read. And so if you can read, be patient with me. So the 10 tips that I talk about in the book are, yes, you can grieve without there being a deeper supernatural meaning. 2, be patient with your loved ones. 3, take care of your physical self. 4, attend to your psychological and emotional needs. 5, there's no time limit on grief. Be patient with yourself. 6, reconnect with nature. 7, postpone major decisions. 8, do something in their honor. 9, cry, and then cry some more. And then 10 is care, is more of a tip geared towards not a person who's grieving, but a person who's just sort of trying to be a support to somebody who is grieving. So that is where we get caring for others who are grieving. You may have heard about the 5 stages of grief. We talked, you know, that's become part of pop culture now. 5 stages of grief, 5 stages of grief. This was developed by Elizabeth Kubler-Ross back in the 1960s. And this book was actually, her model was actually geared towards people who were dying, people who knew that they were dying and they were anticipating death. And so her book was actually not whereas we've sort of adapted it to talk to people, you know, the survivors, right? Those of us who have survived the decease. In reality, when she originally developed the model, it was about helping the person who was terminally ill come to terms with their death and before they died. So those stages are denial, anger, bargaining, depression, and acceptance. one thing that pop culture gets wrong is this idea that we're supposed to go through those stages in order. And so, you know, some people may end up having a level of frustration based on the fact that they don't seem to be going in order. They think they're getting better and then they flip back and they're in another stage and it's bad. And, you know, and so that's one thing that was key when you're reading Elizabeth Kubler-Ross's research, is that it's not intended. Our model was never intended to suggest that this is an orderly process. And acceptance is not necessarily the end goal. Again, it's not an orderly process. Acceptance has to do with just incorporating that person into your life in a new kind of way, right? That they're still a part of your life. They're still a part of your heart. But you just kind of are learning that they're not going to be there in the way that they were before. They're going to be there a new kind of way, and just learn to sort of incorporate that. Not that I'm going to be okay with his death. I'm never going to be okay with his death, right? He died in a car accident. So acceptance does not mean I'm okay with the death. It just means that I'm, you know, moving forward with my life, and I can kind of incorporate him in my life in a new sort of way. Caveat, Elizabeth Kubler-Ross is a little bit of a controversial figure. You know, we learn about Kubler-Ross in grad school. You know, all counseling mental health trainees are going to learn about these stages of grief. And, you know, the research says it's not really any scientific validity behind, you know, this concept of these are the stages that we go through. But in reading her materials and in reading her books, I do feel like a lot of it just sort of resonated. So it may not be scientific, but it does resonate in the sense that it kind of helps you conceptualize what you're going through, right? It kind of helped me conceptualize the big, weighty, heavy feelings that I was feeling and why I felt like I was whipping back and forth and all over the place. So if you decide to read her book, or if you decide to go on and read about her again, she was quite the interesting character in the later years of her life, in the 80s and 90s. She really started getting into some extreme things that we as non-believers would just not be okay with, in terms of, you know, her philosophies about life and that sort of thing. So she is a controversial figure. And again, you know, I acknowledge that there's no scientific basis no scientific evidence that shows that, you know, the validity of the concept of these three stages. But again, like I said, I still like them just because it's a good way to conceptualize. You can go on YouTube. She did a lot of interviews with a lot of terminally ill patients and stuff back in the, like I said, in the 60s. And you can find video that she did. And so it was really touching work, the way she was able to work with the terminally ill patients. So it's unfortunate that later in her life, the stuff kind of got a little derailed. So this is an actual selfie, no lie. This is me. Anyway. I am going to point out a little bit about my favorite tips from the book. And so one of the tips is, yes, you can grieve without there being a deeper supernatural meaning. Earlier, you know, a couple of slides ago, I was about to say something. I said, I'm going to talk about this in a minute. You know, I was pointing out that believers may struggle with, you know, anger at God, or they may struggle with, you know, sort of begging and pleading God, why, you know, just send them back, please. I'll do whatever it takes. But, and I also say, you know, we as non-believers typically won't have to deal with that because we don't believe that stuff, right? Well, yes and no. Because one of the things I point out in the book, if you look at my last bullet point there, it says, it is not unreasonable that you, having encountered that way of thinking much of your life, might manifest those same internalized concepts during your time of extreme vulnerability. So what do I mean? I mean that if you are here in the United States, or, you know, you're in the Western world where, you know, Christianity is you know, the predominating religion, then you understand, you know, that it is just all around us. Again, it's in the movies, right? We hear our friends and loved ones say these things. We see our coworkers, you know, going through grief and mourning. It just becomes part of who we are. If you grow up watching TV, if you grow up, you know, having friends and families, you don't even have to grow up having gone to church. Just growing up in a society that has a lot of religion just kind of baked into the fabric, these things get inside of us, right? These things get in us. And as a result, when we are unstable, unwell, sick, you know, depressed, grieving, we get vulnerable to some of those messages that may have soaked into us unbeknownst to us. So I'm saying all that to say, for example, one of the ladies I mentioned on one of the slides, that part of my inspiration for writing the book was that I was supporting some other people who were going through some things, right? Well, one of the ladies, she struggled a lot with this idea that she was dreaming about him a lot, and she was wondering, like, oh my gosh, is he alive in some afterlife and he's trying to communicate to me? You know, she would talk about sometimes she felt like she was hearing his voice. You know, I think a lot of, you know, I grew up with a super superstitious family, and, you know, my family swore up and down that granddaddy walked through the house on a regular basis, and grandma swore up and down she could hear him walking around in the back of the house for years after he died. And so I think that, you know, it's not unusual that you may, even as a non-believer, have moments where you question, where you wonder, where you think, was that real? Did I really just hear that? Did I really just experience that thing? And we kind of question some of these things because, again, like I said, it's just kind of baked into the fabric of this society. And so, yes, you can grieve. These things can come out of you. And it doesn't necessarily mean that suddenly I'm about to become a believer again, suddenly I'm about to start praying to God again, that sort of thing. Literally, you know, I've had people say to me, like, they experienced a lot of anxiety when those religious things begin to resurface while they're grieving. So they're both grieving, but they're also distressed by the fact that all these religious things that they thought were not an issue for them are coming up. And so I try to normalize that experience for people and say, look, you are really going through something unfathomable. You're really vulnerable right now. There may be some depression or low-level depression, low-level anxiety going on. Do not be surprised. On the flip side, you know, don't be distressed. Just see it as it's part of the grieving process, and it's going to come and go, and I'm going to be okay. I'm going to keep it moving. So yes, you can grieve without there being a deeper supernatural meaning. Another one of my favorite tips, and as a licensed mental health professional, I would be remiss if I did not mention attending to your psychological and emotional needs. Go see a counselor, go and talk to your doctor, go talk to your psychiatrist, take your meds, you know, that sort of thing. I've given talks on medications before, I've given talks on mental health before, and I always kind of like to give this little tidbit of something to think about if a doctor or a counselor or somebody is maybe suggesting to you to consider taking some medication, and then you go home and you Google that medication and you say, oh my God, they want to put me on a medication that's for bipolar. I'm not bipolar. Oh my goodness, they want to put me on a medication that's for schizophrenia. I'm not schizophrenic. I always tell people, think about medications as being for clusters of symptoms. You know, it just so happens that this cluster of symptoms often looks like depression or often looks like bipolar, but it doesn't necessarily mean that that's what you have and therefore that's the medicine you take. You know, just they use, you know, all kinds of medications for different things. We know you've heard of like off-label usage, right? So just because it is often used for this diagnosis, keep in mind, you know, again, like I said, if you have some low level depression symptoms, you may find that you need a little something to kind of help you get over that bump and without necessarily being, you know, depressed or bipolar or schizophrenic or something. But those medicines may still prove to be beneficial to you. My point here is, and these little quotes are from the book, you should let yourself feel as many feelings as you want to feel, but realize that there are actions that you can and should take to make yourself resilient, thereby preventing the emotions from consuming and destroying your life. So again, attend to your psychological and emotional needs. Know that, you know, you can do some, there are things that you can do to sort of try to take care of yourself and make that a priority to do. Reconnect with nature. If you know me, if you've heard any of my talks in the past couple of years, you know that I am an avid hiker. You know, I hike Colorado every summer. I hike almost every Sunday. That is my church. That is my religion, is hiking. And so this one is my absolute favorite one to say, reconnect with nature. If you have time, Robert Frost's After Apple Picking is one of my all-time favorite poems. My first career, I was an English major. So I fell in love with this poem with Robert Frost, and this poem in particular, when I was an undergrad. And the poem is about death. The poem is about a man contemplating his death. And I think it's just an absolutely beautiful poem. And I reference it in the book, and I talk about how it is attempting to connect grief to and death and life to this sort of greater circle of life and what it's like. It's just a beautiful poem. If you get a chance, go check it out. I do talk about something in the book, some research about something called directed attention fatigue and attention restoration theory. So directed attention fatigue is this idea that directed attention requires effort. It plays a central role in achieving focus, is under voluntary control, at least some of the time, is susceptible to fatigue and controls distraction through the use of inhibition. So what does all that mean? It means that we take control of our thoughts on a regular basis, right? Like, this is what we have to do. We have to stay focused. We have to, you know, do our work. We got to drive. We got to focus on this conversation. Like, we learn, you know, we focus, right? We know what to do with ourselves. Unfortunately, sometimes, as it says there, it's susceptible to fatigue. So you know how when you get really tired, it's hard for you to focus. So when you get really tired, you start forgetting things. That is a sign, according to Stephen Kaplan. He would say those are signs that you are experiencing directed attention fatigue. And so attention, his theory of how to treat that, attention restoration theory, is he says we should use something called soft fascination. So soft fascination, as it says here, is a form of attention that requires no effort and thus allows us to restore our directed attention. And so what that's saying is that when you engage in things that don't require a lot of mental effort, when you engage in things that are just effortless for you, and more specifically, when you engage in things that connect you to nature, then that directed attention can recharge and get restored and rejuvenated. So things like, you know, for me, it's hiking. For you, you may not like hiking, but, you know, you might not. You might say, I don't like the outdoors at all, Candace. How I'm supposed to enjoy nature? I don't like the outdoors at all. Well, something as simple as, you know, planting some flowers, sitting on the porch during a rainstorm. Those kinds of things. Anything that you could do that just sort of gets yourself in nature in some form or fashion. I got jet skiing up here. It's funny because the first and only time I went jet skiing, the guide said at the beginning, most people don't relax and enjoy the ride until the last 10 minutes. And then they love it. And then they wish they could go again. And so he was like, relax, enjoy the ride. I did exactly what he said, which is I was full of anxiety the whole time. I was scared I was going to fall off and crash into the reef and get torn up and beat up. And so, and literally the last few minutes, I finally was like, oh, I got this. I could do this. So for me, maybe jet skiing is not going to restore my directed attention because I had so much anxiety doing it. But for you, it might be great. I love to pitch tents. I love to go camping. I can pitch a tent in my sleep. If you ain't never pitched a tent, when you need to restore your directed attention, maybe pitching a tent is not the first, and going camping isn't the first thing you should do. So the idea with soft fascination is to do something that's easy for you, that's good for you, something that you enjoy, and something that you can do without a whole lot of focus and attention and stress and strain and that sort of thing. There's some research that I talk about in the book about heart patients, heart surgery patients, and how there was evidence that those who were exposed to nature in various ways. So one study in particular, they looked at heart surgery patients who had windows in their room and they could, you know, see trees and clouds and stuff like that. And then others who either didn't have a window or they only saw like other buildings and stuff. They didn't really get a good view of nature. Well, those heart surgery patients that had the rooms with good views of nature, actually they recovered faster, they were released faster, they used fewer pain medications, they had fewer complications overall. So there's something to be said about this just general exposure. So another set of researchers decided to sort of take those findings to the next level and say, okay, fine. What happens if, you know, there's no window at all, or there's, you know, there's nothing good to see. Will just some photos in the room help? Will that do the same thing? And sure enough, pictures of nature in the room seem to, the people who had pictures in the room had better outcomes than those who did. So that's not to say that the picture helped, but it does seem, I mean, it doesn't say that it was the, you know, overall cause, but it does suggest that this may be something going on here, because those patients that had them in their room seem, you know, fared better overall. And then the final tip in the book is just what I said at the beginning. It's more of a tip for those people who are supporting a non-believer, who are supporting somebody who's grieving, right? So let's say my best friend lost somebody. These are tips for me on how I can support her better. And they're very practical steps. The entire book is very practical, to be honest with you. It's very short. It's an easy read. It's only about 120 pages or so. And the goal for the book was that you should be able to open this book, point your finger on just about any page, and find something that you can do today to feel better or help somebody else feel better. So the book is intended to be very practical in that way. And so there are some very practical steps, things that I mentioned in the book. Stuff like, for example, if you just, people love to cook meals for people who have lost somebody, right? They love to cook food and bring food over. You know, well, one of the things I talk about in the book is I give a little story in the book about how a really dear friend of mine made me some of the most delicious homemade vegetable soup. She brought me a big container of it. It was so good. I loved it. I ate one bowl of it. It sat in the back of the refrigerator. It molded. I ended up just throwing the whole container away. The point that I make there is that if you're going to give somebody some food, consider just smaller portions, for example, because, you know, otherwise, if you're like me, I couldn't eat. I didn't eat a whole lot. And so I actually got really sick during my time that I was mourning because I was not eating and I wasn't drinking. And so the smaller portions would be better because you can eat it. And then also stuff like disposable dishes, right? Don't bring me more dishes. I already don't do the dishes that I do have. So don't bring me more dishes if I'm, you know, crying and I'm sad and I'm in distress. So it's just little things like that to maybe think about that, you know, that we kind of overlook or we don't think about. It also talks about things like touch, sex life. And of course, it was written during social distance when we were all social distancing so significantly. So it even talks about that a little bit. Here's another funny for you. I'm sorry. My humor is a little dark. You have to forgive me. All right. So I'm almost done. Just a couple of resources that, you know, Grief Beyond Belief is really an amazing website. Griefbeyondbelief.org is really an amazing website. There's tons of resources, books, links to articles, blog posts, just a lot of really cool stuff there. So that's if you're going through grief or you're just kind of interested in more about what, you know, has been said about it from the perspective of non-believers, that would be a good place to go. Greta Christina, you may be familiar with her. She wrote a pretty good book a few years ago, Comforting Thoughts About Death That Have Nothing to Do with God. So that's one. And then of course my book. And then I didn't put it on here, but if you are, you know, mourning and you need some therapy or you need some support in those types of ways, the Secular Therapy Project is, if you've never heard of it, it's a really beautiful thing. The idea is that all of the therapists who are listed, who you could potentially get in contact with through this website, have vowed that they will provide only evidence-based therapeutic interventions. They won't bring religion into the therapy session. In fact, they are expected to be, you know, on the sort of non-believing scale themselves as well. So if they come in and their website says they do pastoral counseling or something like that, they are vetted by a team of people who interview the therapists. They, you know, vet them. They look at their background, and they again, like I said, they have to meet certain standards and certain requirements. And so that's the Secular Therapy Project, and that's a good resource if you're in need of something there. So that concludes my presentation portion.
Thank you so much, Candace. And I wanted to add also that the Humanist Society is available to provide endorsed celebrants to do memorials and funerals, or even end of life ceremonies before the person has passed away. So I just wanted to include that, thehumanistsociety.org. So this is a great time for people to put in their questions either in the Facebook comments or in Zoom Q&A. And I know we've gotten some comments from people on both platforms sharing about the recent passings of people and that they're currently mourning. So thank you for joining us and sharing as you're continuing your healing process. On that note, I actually kind of wanted to jump into, someone asked if you could comment on the euphemisms for died in terms of like passed, passed on, passed away. I know that sometimes there's a little bit of, not per se controversy, but maybe disagreement about the terms that non-religious people feel comfortable using.
Mm-hmm. Again, that kind of, to me, goes back to, you know, the society that we grow up, that we're in, right? There's just, and this is true for everything you could think of, you know, women's periods, for example, you know, sex, you know, all kinds of things. We use euphemisms because we're uncomfortable with the, you know, what the thing actually is. So I wouldn't necessarily, you know, hold it against anybody if they are choosing to use euphemisms like pass away or, you know, that sort of thing. You know, some of this is stuff that you have to unlearn. Some of it is stuff that, you know, is neither here nor there. But I do think that I haven't seen like any kind of research or anything like that talks specifically about those, you know, stuff like euphemisms for death. But again, like I said, I think that it probably is just sort of a function of what we grow up around, right? And what we see and hear on a regular basis. And there is so much discomfort in talking about death in general. And so I think euphemisms, like I said, are just a way for people to try to talk about something that they're uncomfortable talking about. And it just takes time to get more comfortable talking about things like that. You know, it's like suicide, for example. You know, people often worry that if somebody is suicidal and you talk to them about being suicidal, it's going to make them more suicidal and make them want to kill themselves even more because you said suicide. But there, that's actually, you know, we don't find that to be true. And so I think it just takes time to get comfortable with using, you know, more blunt or more factual or more, you know, direct language.
Similar to that, recognizing that there's various ways that people die at various points in their lives. Someone had actually messaged AHA earlier today about stillbirths and miscarriages and abortions is a whole separate area than, you know, tragic accidents, as you had mentioned with like car accidents or health concerns or dying of old age. So have you noticed any differences in the way that people process those situations? And, you know, is there kind of like different forms of mourning based on the reason for someone's death?
No, I don't. I wouldn't imagine that there would be, again, I haven't come across any research to say there's any differences. And just sort of my own professional experience and, you know, just sort of the way I look, you know, what I've seen, how people are mourning and the various things that they're mourning. Loss in general, it often looks the same, you know, from I lost a job to I lost a partner to I lost, you know, I lost a relationship to somebody's actual death or, you know, those types of people go through the same sorts of mourning processes. And I actually say in the book that even though in the book I'm talking specifically about mourning the death of a person, those same tips can be applied to mourning the death of a cat, you know, or mourning the loss of a job. If you are feeling heavy and overwhelmed and depressed and anxious, these are tips that talk about things to do when you're just mentally and emotionally not yourself. So I think that grief is very similar. It looks very similar across all kinds of things. Now, I do understand that there are also, for example, like, you know, social things that come into play that impact grief, right? That can kind of complicate grief. For example, if, you know, back in the, you know, the 80s and the 90s and stuff, you think about if somebody died from AIDS, you know, oh, that was so scary. And that was something that you wanted to keep secret. You didn't want everybody to know. Or, you know, if you had an abortion, you know, oh, you kind of keep that to yourself. You don't want everybody to know that you had an abortion. And so you're grieving in a way that maybe you're not able to get the social support that you need because, you know, because there's some shame around the death of the person or the loss that you experience. So I do think that grief can be complicated by sort of social constructs and social expectations and, you know, how much support there is or is not, you know, I do believe it can be complicated in that way. Just in general, I don't necessarily think that there's necessarily a difference based on the type of loss. I think there could be complications.
And directly connected to that, we have had someone wrote how to cope with the loss of a parent that you did not have a good relationship with. And there's that kind of pressure on people's expectations of how they're processing the death.
And, you know, that comes up almost in almost every talk that I give, right? What do I do when somebody who I don't have a good relationship with, especially I hear parents, you know, what do I do if they die and how do I respond to that? Or people talk about the sense of alienation that they feel or, you know, the various problems that come with the death of somebody that at our very core, right, we are programmed, you know, for lack of a better word, right, to connect to our parents. They are our source of life as infants, right? They take care of us. And so there is a special thing right there between a child and a parent. And so when that is ripped apart, when it is torn apart, be it, you know, regardless of what the reason is, be it abuse or neglect or, you know, just falling apart because of differences of opinions, those sorts of things, those types of losses, I believe, are again, like I said, complicated. Like I was saying in the last comment, right, can complicate the process and make it more difficult because, again, you may be feeling mixed feelings. You know, there may even be a piece of you that's like, I'm glad that little blah 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 is gone. They got on my nerves. But then there's also a part of you that's like, but why couldn't I have had a good relationship with them? Why did it have to be that way? And so again, I don't have any special tips for that particular type of situation, but I do think that it's the most important thing I would say is to be patient with yourself and to be gentle with yourself to understand just how complicated grief can be. And just how you know, a person who's had a bad relationship with a parent and then their parent died, they know better than anybody that these things are complicated. they understand just how complicated it all could be because they've been living with a complicated relationship for years. And so it would be no surprise to me that then dealing with that death is just as complicated as it was dealing with the person when they were alive. So I would say to me, it would mostly be about being patient with yourself, accepting that you're going to experience all kinds of emotions. They're going to be all over the place. And you're not good or bad for experiencing whatever type of emotion. If you're happy and elated, you're not bad that's what you're experiencing. So I would say be patient with yourself. And then, you know, just make sure that you're taking care of the basic needs, right? Make sure that you're healthy and as you can possibly be to sort of get over it, get over the worst of it. But I don't think there's anything necessarily special to do different. You may need more social support or something like that, but the same sorts of things.
And I think that it's also important to recognize that it doesn't always hit you that close to the time of death. You know, as you mentioned at the beginning, that it was that anniversary that kind of brought up those feelings again, and maybe a little like realization of, you know, he's not coming back. Mm-hmm. I think that sometimes, especially for family members, holidays bring up memories, mm-hmm. birthdays, the anniversary of the death. And also recognizing that sometimes it's not even the people closest to us who were impacted by. I know there's a lot of feelings when the queen died, both of mourning and anger and concerns about what happens after her.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I think we experience so many types of losses, and we can experience them in so many ways. A friend of mine who died, was it Olivia Newton-John who died recently? Mm-hmm. And he was just so depressed. I mean, we were genuinely worried about this man for a couple of days. He was so depressed, you know, about her passing. And so I, you know, it's true, right? Different things are going to hit people in different ways. And I always say, you know, it's all about just kind of being patient with yourself and understanding this is all part of the human experience, right? And, you know, like you said, one death over here may not impact me that much, but Olivia Newton-John might throw me for a loop. You know, we see it when a lot of big people die, right? Like you said, the Queen or, you know, Michael Jackson or whoever, right? Like people go crazy when big, and I don't mean crazy, but you know what I'm saying? Like they experience very strong emotions, you know, when there are big losses, and sometimes things that somebody might consider to be a small loss can really throw somebody off. And so we have to be patient with ourselves and patient with the people who are experiencing those losses.
So one of the tips you had mentioned was about not making a big life decision or big decisions. Mm-hmm. Can you expand on that? Because some people were kind of asking about, you know, how they've either struggled with coming back to their original career or were, you know, feeling like they had to kind of snap back into their real life.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So what I talk about in the book is, you know, of course, there are some things that you just can't avoid, right? Like if the person had a will or something like that, that's got to be attended to in a timely manner. Let's say somebody dies and you can't afford the mortgage by yourself anymore. You got to put that house on the market and sell it and get your finances stable again. You know, there are situations where it is a big deal, it's got to be done. And so what I talk about in the book is leaning on, when there are big decisions that have to be made, lean on like real professional support, right? If you need to vent with your friends, that sort of thing, that's great. But if you got to sell a house, lean on a realtor. If you got to deal with a will, lean on a lawyer. If you got to deal with, you know, whatever types of things you got to deal with, lean on, you know, try to leverage some professional support if you can get it. Of course, I know these things, sometimes these services cost money and maybe people don't have money. But when at all possible, you know, try not to, you know, resist. I say in the book, what's the phrase I use? I use high-end retail therapy, right? Like, you know, I get depressed and so I go out and get a $500 tattoo. You know, or a new car would make me feel better or something like that. Like try to avoid those types of things, right? I even talk about relationships. You know, it's not uncommon for you know, somebody to experience a major loss, and then immediately they're, you know, back into a new relationship, or maybe they had a breakup and they go back into a major relationship or something like that. And maybe they're not all the way ready for that. I talk in the book about how we, there's in the mental health world, we talk about schemas. And a schema is like just a normal, like our sort of internal script that guides how we function on a daily basis. And so we have these sort of internal things that build up, and maybe we learn not to depend on those scripts because maybe they're not helpful, right? I'm an emotional eater. So one of my scripts is when I'm sad and depressed, you need something sweet. It's going to help you feel better, Candace, you know, and when I'm strong, I can resist that. And I can say, nope, I'm not going to eat this candy bar today, you know, whatever. But when I'm depressed and I'm weak, like I said, that kind of loses its power. And I fall back onto the original script that says overeat when you're depressed. And then I do that thing. And so that's what I'm saying. We have to be careful because when we're grieving or when we're in these types of periods where, you know, our mental, emotional health, physical health is compromised, those scripts may not be the best thing to serve us. And we kind of fall back on them naturally because we can't do the work that we normally do. And so you have to be mindful that you may be making decisions based on old scripts, flawed scripts, you know, just emotions being out of whack. So I don't feel like I say anything that's especially surprising in that particular tip, but one of the points that I make, and I remember one time I got some feedback from somebody that was like, one of the reviews on Amazon commented that like, oh, this book is so simple. And I don't think that, you know, I think that anybody of a certain age would know this stuff already. And I thought, well, I kind of say that in the book, that I really am not saying anything that's outrageously going to blow your mind. What I feel is the value of the book, though, is that when it was like when you are in these really, really deep moments of depression and despair and being distraught and distressed, the things that we think make the most sense, the things that we think, oh, that's just innate. I would always remember to drink water every day. Right? Who forgets to drink water? A person who's extremely depressed and in the morning might forget, oh man, it's been 24 hours and I haven't had a single drink of water. Well, something like this book that says, have you eaten today? Have you drunk today? You know, that's the sort of thing that can just sort of trigger a person who's actually going through these things to think about some things that are kind of falling under the radar that are being lost because of the depression and the distress. So in terms of that specific one, what do I say about making decisions? I think the chapter is interesting because I do talk about research. I talk about research on decision-making and that sort of thing and how it is impaired when we're stressed out. So there's interesting information there that maybe you hadn't heard in that sense of like, what does the research say about decision-making? But as far as my actual tips, like I said, it's really practical stuff. And the point is that we don't always think about these things when we're extra distressed. And so the book is sort of like the little friend to take you by the hand and say, think about this thing, slow down, think, you know, make sure you're making a wise decision here.
And yeah, as you say that kind of pausing in order to allow ourselves time to process and think can be done throughout our lives and maybe even help. There were some comments and questions about, you know, the frustrations we feel about not being able to say goodbye to people or, you know, that are feeling like, you know, it wasn't the right time and wishing that we had more time. And so I think that if we kind of can hold that awareness in us and be maybe more intentional with our relationships and, you know, be more active in trying to make the most of the time that we have, that kind of takes some of that pressure off of the final days or the time afterwards.
Yeah. The unexpected loss can be, and you know, untimely loss especially can just really be devastating in a really unique kind of way, as I'm sure most people would imagine or know.
So we have someone who's wondering, they understand the value of dealing with grief by supporting others who are grieving, but is there a downside to doing that?
Let's see, is there a downside? I think that we are inherently social creatures. And I think that so much of what we find to be beneficial, it has to do with maintaining healthy human connections, right? I mean, we're humanists, right? We believe that we're all we got. We got to take care of each other. And nobody is Superman or Superwoman or the strongest, best version of themselves all the time. And so sometimes we need other people to kind of, you know, like I said, take us by the hand, hold us up, prop us up. I would say that maybe it might become unhealthy or unhelpful if you're really trying to push a person to move faster than they're ready to move. For example, you know, and I talk in the book in that chapter about supporting people. You know, I say, you know, don't be surprised if person that's grieving doesn't return text messages, doesn't return phone calls, doesn't come to the birthday party, doesn't go to dinner, you know, because that, you know, that's just where they're at. They're barely making it as it is. And so if you calling this person every day, go, why are you not answering my calls? Why are you not responding to my text messages? Why you skip my birthday dinner? That stuff is not going to be helpful, you know. And I do say in the book, you know, don't give up, right? Don't give up on trying to help the person, but do be mindful that, you know, do be mindful about whether or not you might be pushing them too far or too fast, or, you know, you kind of got to gauge it based on how they're responding to you. But you do have to be, you know, sort of, and I say in the book about, you know, kind of existing in their world on the edges, kind of keeping an eye on them, right? Like, maybe you're not really responding to my text messages every day, but, you know, I'm going to still text you anyway, because one of these days you're going to text me back, but I'm not going to text you and cuss you out. You know what I'm saying? So I talk about just sort of like being in their world, but maybe being on the edges of the world, of their life and of their world, if necessary, to kind of try to keep an eye on them, but not push them too hard, too fast. So I can see how attempts to support somebody could become unhealthy. But again, like I said, I believe that ultimately at the end of the day, the social support is critical to making it through all manner of issues that we have in life. So I would definitely say don't give up on trying. And I say in the book, actually, one of the tips, like I said, is to be patient with your loved ones, to know that especially if somebody else is grieving too, let's say it's you and your sister grieving your mother's death, well, you're both struggling, right? You're both trying to do it. So I got to have patience and compassion for myself, but also I got to have patience and compassion for my sister, right? Because we're both struggling. So it always, to me, comes back to being compassionate and being patient with others and with ourselves.
And that becomes very apparent when it comes to the memorial service for an individual. I know often our humanist celebrants have a challenge of wanting to incorporate the religious traditions that some of the family members or friends have, but also understand if that person was non-religious, or if, you know, some of their family and friends are non-religious and don't want it to turn into an uncomfortable, very, you know, God-focused service. So I don't know if your book goes into a little bit about like the service aspect or the event aspect of death.
Mm-hmm. No, that's a good one. I don't really go into that too much. Again, like I said, I just sort of talked briefly in the chapter about being patient with your loved ones. You know, that's sort of the main thing that I say, is like recognizing that they are grieving as well. And again, they've got the, you know, same, you know, these beliefs that have been ingrained in them since they were a child, right? And so they're kind of going off of their scripts, right? They're going off of the things that they know to be true. And so you kind of have to be careful. I mean, be patient with other people in their grieving process as well. And if you have to distance yourself. If somebody is saying, oh, let me pray for you, and you don't want to be prayed for, don't be afraid to speak up for yourself and say, no, don't pray for me. The flip side is, you know, somebody prayed for me, and I was in utter distress, despair. I was helpless to respond to this woman. She ran up to me, she grabbed me, she bear hugged me, and just started praying. And I'm like, first of all, I ain't asked you to pray for me. But second of all, I'm standing in this parking lot, boo-hoo sobbing, barely standing on my own strength. I do not have it in me to tell this sweet 80-year-old woman who's giving me the best that she got to leave me the blank alone. Don't pray for me. I didn't have it in me. If you have it in you, then by all means, you know, let people know. I don't believe this. All my friends and family do know that. And, you know, the people who are closest to me knew not to give that to me. This was a random old lady that didn't know me. She just saw me about to faint in the parking lot. And so, you know, my friends and family and stuff know this about me. So they didn't try to come at me with that sort of stuff. And so I, you know, like I said, you kind of have to balance it based on one, your own personality, based on what you got to give, you know, how strong, you know, what do you have in that moment? You may not have it in you, but then at the same time, again, patience with self, patience with others, you know, communicating to them, you know what, I don't believe that, no thank you. Or, you know, like I said, if there's a lot going on, say at repass after church, after the service, right, and there's a whole lot of praying and stuff, if you need to leave and excuse yourself, leave and excuse yourself, and don't feel bad. You know, do what you got to do to sort of take care of yourself.
And I guess connected to, and you mentioned about supporting others grieving, if somebody knows that you are not religious and is seeing someone come, you know, giving you that religious talk, if they can step in there and kind, you know, they don't even necessarily need to set the person straight, but even just be a distraction or like a bumper or something. So, you know, redirect the conversation, direct someone to food, whatever eases
it. That's a great example. Exactly. Some allies step in, save me, please. You know, but yeah, I mean, I do. I mean, I think that it's just really difficult when you're a non-believer trying to deal with a bunch of believers around you. So, you know, you do kind of have to find that balance between you doing what's best for you. And again, patience with the other people as well who are doing the best they can do. You know, this is all they know. They lost somebody too, you know, and they're just doing the best they can do. So you kind of have to, if you look at it from that perspective, it's kind of like, okay, leave me alone, but I'm not going to fuss at you.
Mm-hmm. So another area of death that you may not have tapped into in your writing, but may also have thoughts on is, you know, what actually happens to the body afterwards. And I know sometimes when people make their final decisions, they want to have a place where people can gather, like a cemetery, or, you know, the place where they spread the ashes. Also, human composting has become a more available thing in order to, for us to literally give back to the earth. So I don't know, I'm kind of curious if you had some thoughts on that, or have noticed that there's, you know, kind of trends in society.
So again, I don't talk about that directly in the book, but I have been on a panel several times actually now with the woman, I can't remember her name at the moment, but her organization is called Compassion and Choices. Compassion and Choices. And they talk a lot about, she talks a lot about, you know, be prepared. Like, we need to be thinking about the uncomfortable stuff now, right? Mm-hmm. Especially non-believers, especially humanists, you know, because otherwise, if we are from a religious family, the default is going to be, you're going to get a religious wedding, you're going to get a funeral, you're going to get a religious burial, you're going to get a religious ceremony. You know, if you have concerns that those things might happen, it's time to get some things in writing. Now is the time to get things in writing. And so Compassion and Choices has a lot of documents and forms and things like that, that are forms that can turn into legal documents to say, this is what I expect, this is what I want for my death, this is what I want to happen with my body, this is what I want to happen with this, that, and the third. It's not just about where does my house and my car and my bank account go, who does that go to, but it's also, you know, like I said, about what do I want you to do with my body. You know, and one thing I like about my family, my immediate family, mama, daddy, brother, sister, you know, my child, nieces and nephews, we've all talked amongst each other very openly about what we want for our, like, what do we want to happen with our bodies, and what kind of ceremony or service or celebration, you know, we want to have. And so I do feel very lucky that I'm able to have that conversation. I'm the only, I and my daughter, we're the only two non-believers in my family that I know of. There may be some other people. I got some suspicions of a couple people, but they haven't come out to me yet. But I do feel lucky in the sense that my family at least acknowledges that Candace doesn't want this. You know, I'm lucky that I have an 18-year-old daughter who can put her foot down and say, you are not gonna do this to my mom, or, you know, whatever. So I say all of that to say, take some time now to think about these things. If you are worried that you may have family members who do something, you know, with your body that you don't want, or do some type of ceremony that you don't want, you need to get that stuff in writing now. And you need to find you an ally in the family who can be one of the ones that's, you know, sort of speaks up and ensures that your wishes are respected. But yes, things like human, I used to say, the human compost thing, I think is really neat. That's what my daughter wants. She wants to be buried with a tree. I used to say, I heard years and years and years ago about this thing where they can turn you, you know, they compress you and turn you into like a little diamond and then shoot you into space. I don't know if that's a real thing or not, but I was like, oh, I want to be a diamond and be shot into space. That'd be great. But now my family knows, you know, just burn me up and throw me off a mountain. That's the best thing I could do. You know, I know my mama wants to, we all want to be cremated. My mom wants to be cremated and sprinkled in a garden. My daddy wants to be cremated. And he's like, I don't care what y'all do with me. Yo, just throw me in a garden somewhere. Put me, you know, with some something. So we kind of have all talked about that stuff. And I could tell you what all of my family members want, because we've all sat down and talked about it. So, you know, to kind of go back to a previous comment about euphemisms and stuff like that, now is not the time to be shy about communicating your thoughts and wants and feelings about what you want.
Yeah, my one experience with the green burial, which luckily happened just before the pandemic lockdown, so we were able to be together, but the family independently did a wrapping ceremony of the body. Mm-hmm. And then when we were all together for the service, similar to the Jewish tradition of like everyone shoveling some dirt, like we all put some like flowers or branches to kind of help with the composting process. So there was sort of a symbolic saying goodbye and helping the body, you know, be welcomed by that spot in the earth.
Yeah. Oh, that's nice. I love it.
So we're getting towards the end of our time. Thank you to all those people that are actively chatting. This is kind of for the last question, kind of gets back to when you're talking about the taking care of yourself and taking your meds. Someone asked, what's your take on guided use of psychedelics to aid grief therapy for both the dying and those processing someone's death? This is slated to start in Oregon in the near term, and I wonder if this is viewed from how it's viewed from a therapist perspective.
I'll have to look that up. I had not heard about that. Actually, I haven't heard about using psychedelics for grief management. Just my personal beliefs about things like marijuana, for example. You know, my personal belief is that I do see medicinal value in it. I do think that, you know, these things that can kind of help with stress relief, these things that can help with, with kind of allowing ourselves to experience our emotions uninhibited. You know, I know mushrooms, you know, supposedly people experience all kinds of cathartic, you know, experiences when they're on mushrooms, things like that. So I don't know of any research. I'm going to go look now because I love, you know, what's the research on marijuana? I want to know all day long. Tell me. And so I'm going to go look it up. But just what we know about the benefits that things like, you know, marijuana and even like mushrooms and stuff like that, just the things that we see that they're able to do, I can see how they would be beneficial in a grief situation, because again, like I said, it's anxiety management, it's mood boosting, it's, you know, taking down our inhibitions so we can process stuff, certain emotions and things differently. You know, it helps if you do it with somebody, it can help with bonding with that person and social cohesion and those sorts of things. So again, like I said, I don't know of any research, but just sort of in my own thinking about it, I could see how it could probably be beneficial. And I would love to see more, you know, laws that allow people to kind of access some of these natural remedies. I definitely believe in the value of them.
Thank you so much, Candace. I'd like to give you a chance, if you have other final thoughts or calls to action you can share with us.
No, I mean, I think this is a great discussion. I got in, a lot of my thoughts, and I appreciate all of the questions that everybody sent in. You know, go buy my book. Can I say that? my first book, Ebony Exodus Project, is on Amazon. On Death, Dying, and Disbelief is on Amazon. I also contribute a chapter to a book called Women Versus Faith, the case for the women versus religion, the case for faith, for against faith, and for freedom. That's a common Women Versus Religion is the main title. So those are all available on Amazon. They're available at the major retailers online, like Barnes and Noble and, you know, Borders and things like that. I do have a Ebony Exodus has a Facebook page at Ebony Exodus. I have not relaunched my website yet. A long, crazy story there. I will be relaunching ebonyexodus.com eventually. But the main thing would be just, you can go get the books from, you know, Amazon and Barnes and Noble and Borders and places like that.
We'll make sure to include the links to the book and Candace's other work along with this video, which will be available on the AHA YouTube channel and AHA Center for Education website. But with that, thank you all for joining us. Candace, of course, thank you again for sharing your wisdom and experience. And hope everyone has a great rest of your day. You can visit AmericanHumanist.org to join AHA, check out our other events. We're going to soon have information about the annual conference, which will be hybrid. And you also can check out other recordings from our events. And we always appreciate your support. You can donate at AmericanHumanist.org/education.